Collaboration between Theatre Academy's Performing Arts Research Centre, Arts Equal Research Initiative, and Open Campus of the University of the Arts Helsinki. Following the open science ideology that aims to make scientific research, data, and dissemination available, accessible to all levels of an inquiring society, this lecture will be streamed online and published on the Arts Equal website. Just that you know, this will be streamed. Recent research and also a growing number of national and international green papers and policies propose that the arts could remarkably boost social well-being, health, and sustainable growth. In Finland and elsewhere in Europe, there are increasingly new initiatives that subscribe to these new ways of thinking about the value of the arts for society. Such initiatives have generated new and often interdisciplinary job opportunities for artists and arts pedagogues, artist researchers, and artists as developers. Some of these opportunities may also have challenged professional identities of artists and the modernist paradigm of the artist as an independent author. To address this phenomenon, today we'll discuss the concept of hybrid artist, and we'll also talk about arts pedagogy beyond the arts. Our guest speaker, internationally distinguished art sociologist Pascal Gillen, comes from the Netherlands. He's director of the Research Center Arts in Society at the Groningen University, where he's professor for sociology of art and cultural politics. He's also editor-in-chief of the book series Arts in Society. Pascal has written several books on contemporary art, cultural heritage, and cultural politics. Today, he will talk about macrosocial changes such as neoliberalism, post-Fordism, and changes in the modern art world, as well as possibilities and obstacles for creative and pedagogic work. This lecture is based on his research on the artists' careers in recent years, as well as the books Art Education Beyond Art, Teaching Art in Times of Change, Being an Artist in Post-Fordist Times, Mobile Autonomy, The Murmuring of the Artistic Multitude, and Creativity and Other Fundamentalisms. Please welcome Pascal Gillen.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting me, Kai, at this beautiful program. Do you hear me? That's the first question. Okay, that's a cool thing. Okay, what I try to do today is talking about research I've done for, I think, the past 20 years or something like that, about artistic careers. It started all with, it started in a way with my PhD research, which was about artistic selections in the fields of contemporary dance and the visual arts. I compared those two. And it took a long run. I think the last research we did was 1 year ago, where we did interviews with 1,800 creative workers, so not only artists, also architects, also designers, web designers, etc., all over Europe. We interviewed them, and we always asked them, in a way, the same question: what do you need to stay creative on the long run, and how do you build up your career until now? That's the main question. So before I go into my lecture, I will give a kind of background information which also frames, in a way, the whole lecture. And it is not so much about my research, but it's about the way I followed the last 20 years to do my research. And it's also very much related to the book series Arts in Society. That's why it's in the back. It's promotion. But it is not about this. It is, I try to explain a little bit about how the books are composed, but also how my lecture is composed, and also how my research nowadays is composed in this way. And this really frames it. First of all, I think Kai mentioned that I'm a sociologist, so I'm schooled in very classical empirical, doing empirical research, data analysis, quantitative and qualitative, especially more qualitative research doing. And I did this also for my PhD, so almost, I finished it, I think, 16 years ago. And I started to realize when I was a postdoc researcher that there were a lot of troubles with this kind of sociology, and especially this kind of art sociology, culture sociology. I saw around me a lot of sociologists which did a great job, who are perfect methodologists, but considering questions about art and culture, they completely questioned the wrong questions in this field. And I came up with this at a certain moment when I was interviewing artists for a research again. It was a research and assignment of the government. They want to know something about artistic careers. And at a certain moment, I was interviewing the Italian artist Michelangelo Pistoletto. It's an Arte Povera artist, an older man, about his organization, which he has at a certain moment. And at that moment, I realized, in fact, as sociologists, we don't take the artist serious. It is really, we always talk around the artist, but not about the artist, and definitely not about his or her art and what it is doing. So that made me realize at a certain moment that how can I involve artistic concepts and also even artistic work in scientific or sociology at all. For example, when Michelangelo Pistoletto mentioned the word, when we were talking at the fashionable word exodus, he had, at a certain moment came up with the word inodus. I said, oh, what is this about? But then you take it seriously and look at what is the word about? Can I use it in my empirical research? Is there an empirical ground for it? But also his whole idea of the mirror he uses, I use it a lot afterwards in doing research about cultural heritage, the relationship between cultural heritage and art. I don't want to go in detail for that, but that's an important step. There comes something in the research which is also metaphoric, speculative at a certain moment, and it dialogues in a way or negotiates with this kind of empirical data. Working with empirical data has also the disadvantage that you only can say what is or what was and not look forward in a way. In a way, art can help with this, to do this. But you come, of course, at a very tricky place there. It is between reality, so-called empirical reality, and fiction. Another step what was important was 1999 in doing research. At that moment, I read the book Empire of Antonio Negri and Michael Hart. Heavy neo-Marxistic stuff, critical theory. But what was interesting about the book, which came later on, I think in 2001, 2002, a bestseller, is in this book, they describe how the world in their eyes functions at this moment, the whole world constellation, empire. And they foresee already in this book the 9/11 attacks. And they say, this will happen somewhere because of the world constellation, how it functions now. That's why it became a bestseller, the book afterwards. Anyway, this, what is not so interesting in a way for me is this neo-Marxistic stuff. But what is interesting is the whole idea that it made me reflect about my own practice as a sociologist, that I saw there is always a bigger story. There's a kind of bigger story, and I saw this also with all my colleagues of sociologists. They have a kind of fixed research agenda. For example, at the end of the 80s and beginning of the 90s, it was all about cultural diversity. When you want to have research money, please do something, apply for an application about cultural diversity. Then in the middle of the 90s, it was about gender differentiation, and nowadays it's about cultural entrepreneurship. So there is a kind of very strange hidden agenda in this kind of field of sociological or broader, probably economical and political research. So I was interested very much, what is the bigger story? Why do I ask the questions, why I ask these questions at this moment? And why is it that all my colleagues also ask the same questions at a certain moment? So it was this bigger story which interested me, and that will also frame, I think, my lecture, and also frames all the things I do in the books, but also in research. It's always balancing between those three, and that's what I call my praxis. It's a kind of kind of cooking with we make also beers. It's with a lot of beer, and something go completely wrong. Sometimes it stays just fiction and fantasy. Sometimes it's very much empirical based. This is kind of balancing, always between those three. What we try. To do. Anyway, this is just to give you, it's a long introduction, I know, but it's an introduction to make understandable what comes up now. So let's talk about artistic careers and how they developed, let's say, since modernity until now, and how I see what are a kind of ways of scenarios nowadays. When we think about the artist, let's say almost until the 80s, but I would say until the 70s, artistic careers were very much related to what we call institutions. And 19th century institutions were all built up like this. I mentioned this title, The Modern Institution of Institutions, because to institute in English means also to rise, to put up, verticality, to institute. And when you Google institute, you immediately get this kind of picture, very fast. This is the brand or the emblem or the model of the institution. But I think it's a very correct picture of it, in that sense that every institution starting from the 19th century had a kind of foundation, a very strong foundation where it stands at. It has this kind of vertical pillars in it, and it has this arrow on top which gives you grandeur to look at the sky, the ideals of the institution. So for me, this kind of picture represents the institution very well. It's all about verticality, it's all about grandeur, and it has a strong fundament under our base, under its construction. For big deal, art was made in those institutions and organized in those institutions, but in fact, whole society was organized, Western society at least, was organized in this kind of pillars. I call it also with sociologists Botanski and Thévenot, value regimes or something like that. Let's take, for example, the value regime or the pillar of knowledge, which has ideal, the sky to look at evolution, human evolution. The institution is the university who protects also these value regimes, and it stands always on its own history, and it has its own archive. Most of, let's say, starting from 19th century, society was organized like that, vertical, but also those institutions, like, for example, the university, protected also very much the borders of its own, in a collective way, of its own field against those other institutions which had also border protections. Also, the market is, for me, an institution which hopes, when it's a good market system, hopes for welfare for all the people. Economy is the practice, and the market is, in fact, the organization, how it is done. This is very much the world until the 1970s, 1980s, how it is organized, Every system had its own values. But in the 80s, 90s, happened something which, and here is already the word, hybridizes those fields. There is a kind of mixture or a kind of, the borders between them become weaker and weaker. And especially they are not protected anymore in a collective institutionalized way. I give one example of my own work field, the university. I was some years ago in the Netherlands in a tenure track. I probably, most of you know what this is about, is to make a step in your career, to become from associate, or no, assistant professor, then associate professor, then full professor. And it's a contract for 4 years in this tenure track. In this contract stood that I had to bring in 300,000 euros from the private markets. So, or can be also government assignments or something like that. So, but what, when this is in your contract, there happens something very strange in your institution, because then the research agenda is not only detected by an autonomous field which is orientated to the values of evolution, but maybe also to the values of the economy or the values of political power. So this is very strange then. This means that also at that moment the university has not at all anymore a say about what is real knowledge and what is not real knowledge. Because other agendas come in. And this is very much happening, starting from the 70s already, with universities, etc. And that's where also the process of hybridization on a macro-sociological level between those fields starts. So the results, again, maybe how was in this kind of institutional context build up an artistic career was also very much in what I call an institutionalized way. When we ask, still nowadays, when we ask artists, those 1,800 in Europe, ask them how, what do you need to build up an artistic career, they almost come with the same answer, and it's this one. We need, in fact, they say, four fields, four domains to survive on the long run for our activities. And those fields were in the past, that's my point, institutionalized and also in an institutional way protected. Nowadays, artists still need those fields, but they are not anymore collective, institutionalized, protected. But they still have it in their mind. They want to have those four fields to survive. What are those four fields about? First of all they say, when you ask them, what do you need to make work? I need a studio. Or a kind of home situation where I feel safe. A domestic space, we called it afterwards. This is a place of respect. That means that you can do there a lot of rubbish, and that you can experiment. But it's all, you can do this because you have there a kind of relationship of intimacy and trust. Most of the artists say, it is my boyfriend or girlfriend who says that this work can see the world. And otherwise, maybe I destroy it. This is a real kind close of relationship you have there with close friends, with family members, etc. It's also a place of traditions and rituals. Every morning, 3 cups of coffee before I start. Listening endlessly to the same CD before I do something, or something like that. It's a kind of ritual place, and those rituals you need to build in what I call your own time. You have your own time there. You can lose also yourself in time, in this place. So that's the domestic space about, very important. for self-reflection, development, in a way. The second place they mentioned is the peers. The peers is, let's take as an example, an art school. When it's a good art school and it's professionally organized with professionals of the art field, it's a kind of peers where you are confronted for the first time with other professionals. You're confronted there with the canon, people who know something about your discipline or field. So knowledge is engaged there. But it is also a relationship, hopefully also still with respect, like in the domestics field, but it's also always a relationship of evaluation. Even when you, as a student, go for a beer with your teacher after school in an informal way, you know everything what I say can be evaluated. So this is another kind of relationship you have or build up in this kind of peers, but also the relationship you have with other curators or critics in this field is always also a relationship of evaluation. Everything what you said can be evaluated. But it's also a place of negotiation and discussion. It means that, for example, let's take this anecdote as an example. An artist, let's say it's in a classical painting room, he's painting in the classroom, the teacher comes in and says, oh my God, no, Van Gogh made this already so many years ago. And then the artist says, no, I do something else. Da, da, da. And then you get the negotiation, the discussion. This is negotiation between the individual and what he or she wants and the canon. This kind of position you have there. Those two fields are very much important for research and development. And again, it's repeated in research that they say, yes, we need those places. Also, very successful artists say, we need these places to go back at a certain moment in life. The marketplace, when you want to make a living in a way of your work, you need a market. A market is, for me, I define it very broad. It can be also when you get subsidized by government. For me, market means that you can exchange your artistic doing, activities, products, for money. That's all. It's a pure, let's say, quantitative relationship in money in which you have completely other relationships than in domestic sphere or the peers. It's always a relationship of competition. Even when you live from subsidizing, you know when I, as an artist, get the subsidizing, another one maybe don't get it. It's always a relationship of competition in this field. But a very important quality of the market is that you learn to quantify yourself. You learn to work, for example, to a deadline. Or you learn also to quantify all the materials you need to make a work. You learn to quantify time to make a product, etc. So a very important quality, again, is of the market is what we also could call nowadays kind of good bookkeeping, but also good management of your own practice. You learn to rationalize your own practice in quantities. So money relationships are the purest relationships in this situation. That's why I also mentioned the auction as a kind of pure form. The auction is a place where you can buy and the work of art completely anonymous, without knowing anything about art history, anything about the artist. You don't need to know the artist at all. So the only thing what counts is that you put money on the table. But it's the same relationship you have when you buy a ticket for a theater piece. You don't have to argue why you go to this theater piece. It's only you have 15 euros or 20 euros, you buy the ticket. It's also when you are zapping on Netflix. It's this kind of relationship. You pay the abonnement and that's it. That's the more purest relationship. This means also that most art markets, also commercial art markets, are not pure markets. There's always something else involved, not only this pure money relationship. There are also always social relationships in it, etc. So trade exchange is center for this market situation, and I put it the name Adam Smith there. Probably you all know him. Adam Smith, as we know him, and I say it a little bit blunt, was in fact a defender of the free market. And he also foresaw that you, in the best way, in an ideal sense, you better can organize almost whole society as a kind of market. It was really liberal thinking. But Adam Smith said already in his time, you can do this, try to make kind of society a market, but never do this for two fields. Never organize healthcare as a market, and never do this for education. When you do this, the market itself will collapse. That was his reasoning about it. I come to this later. Last field is civil. When you civil space, when you want to make, especially art, or want to produce new things, you have to argue why you make those new things and why it is art at all. So it is a place of argumentation and finding public value for your ideas. It's something else than a market where you only give the money and that's the only relationship in central. It is really the place where you have to explain. So for me, the civil space is also when you write down an application to get subsidized and you argue, I want to make this exhibition and that's the reason why it has to be done now. At that moment, you start to argue and you start to be in a kind of civil space. It's so, you talk about qualities, what's the quality of your work, why it's, it has a kind of value. It is about representation. So for me, the civil space is also an exhibition room, semi-public museum, for example. So where you represent work. I think the word exhibition also means, in formal Latin, making a public argument. Is the meaning of exhibition. So my point is, artists need those four spaces. There has to be a kind of balance between those four. Then they go to the market, then they have to go back to the domestic space for research and development, etc. And of course, you see this also almost literally in careers. Most of the young artists start in the domestic sphere, then go to school, to the peers, and when they are lucky, they can make a living of it on the market and the civil space. They can show their work or perform their work, etc. But the problem is when you are a very successful artist, and we interviewed a lot of very successful artists, that they get stuck here in the civil space, but also in the market. And we saw it especially with visual artists, also very successful one, not only the frustrated artists who didn't get it. A lot of them said when we went to want to go for an interview, come before 11 o'clock, because after 11 o'clock they start drinking. It's really a social problem, especially in visual art fields and architects. It's very strange that we saw it, and opera singers. Anyway, I don't know why, not dancers, but that has a reason, I think. But of course, yeah, we laughed also with this, but it is a serious social problem. And it has to do not with frustration, most of the time it has to do with success. Yeah? It were the Luc Tuymanses, the Marlene Dumas we interviewed, who had this kind of problems. And they said it literally, I have no time anymore to go back there, to take my time, to rethink my work. And what happens then, it's all what we know. They get stuck in their work. They repeat themselves, and therefore they do the same idea. But it's very interesting, and it was Luc Tuymans who talked about this, what a misery it is to stay only in the civil field. He says, at a certain moment when you cannot go back to the peers, you are surrounded more and more by groupies, by fans. And the hugest problem by fans is that they are very polite and always say that you are so good. And especially they don't criticize you in a good way. They can criticize you sometimes in a sentimental way because you don't give them a lot of attention, for example, but they are not criticizing your work in a sufficient way anymore. They always say it's good, it's well done, etc., etc. And when you only get surrounded by those people, you get stuck at a certain moment because you have no input anymore of these peers who really dares to say, or your girlfriend or friend who really dares to say, this is rubbish what you're doing, or you're repeating yourself. It's again and again the same story what you're telling now. Stop with it. So you need this kind of confrontation. You need to go back at a certain moment to this place. And also successful artists can be helpless. And very interesting is then they start drinking, because it's very interesting. Of course, this is the critique on a lot of artists. They starting repeating themselves. The first who knows is the artist himself. He knows, he's aware. And then the psychological problem starts. Because he knows he sticks. He knows better than everybody else. And he tries to do other things, but it doesn't work anymore. And that's why they need those places. Again, those places were institutionalized, defended, let's say, until the 70s, 80s. Artists still need it, but nowadays they have to protect them on an individual level. It's their own responsibility. For example, the domestic space was protected by institution, family, which collapses totally after the 70s. You have one parent families, etc. So this kind of solidarity already is changing in this field. Sorry, you have a question. Oh, yeah, we have a lot of examples that, when they work with the manager, in the visual arts fields, it's most of the time the commercial gallery owner, but it can be in the theater field, the business manager, as we call it, I think, for companies, etc. And what is interesting, of course, when you have the opportunity to work with somebody like this, they take tasks in other fields for you. You can solve the balance in this whole thing by working together with a arts manager or cultural manager who does this task for you as an artist. Do you mean that? No. No, I see you looking, and that's not what you mean.
I work with an artist development, and this is what I've been trying to figure out, what is the kind of, how can I, what can I do from an artist perspective that it actually helps them to go through this cycle? Because I've been researching what happens to artists when that invisible wall hits and they can't, the opportunities are there, but they cannot.
I know two kinds of arts management. One is, in fact, a very traditional one. This is the relationship between, for example, the commercial gallery owner and the artist, and that's the good one. In that sense, that they safeguard, in a way, time and space for the artist. That's what they do. Sometimes in a very informal and almost emotional way, but anyway, they do. This is kind of protection of the artist, that he can stay or that he can go back at certain moments. They manage also even his or her, but yeah, most of the time it was still his representation in this field. So they manage, now you have to go. This is the place to be. Not there, no. No, you have to go. So this is time management even. So this is the good way. The bad way is what we see nowadays more and more with arts manager and what is understood by management of arts companies, etc., is that they give their employers, the artists, the dancers, for example, in a big company, a lot of work that has nothing to do with their work. For example, fill in this thing that you have done your job well. Then it's a problem. Then it becomes problematic. This is the worst way of managing. But I come back to this when I talk about art schools also and management and how this relationship works. Anyway, so this is something which comes back. But I have to say also I'm still doing research on it again and again, because maybe this is not valuable for all art fields, or maybe it can change over time, what is necessary for artists. But in a way, it's confirmed again and again in the data that artists need those four spaces. What's happening now on the macro-sociological level? So we started with those pillars, institutions in which artists from the 19th century grew. It is this. The world is becoming flat, not vertical anymore, and wet. And you see this literally. Artists surf on the internet, but also on the water, from one project to another. Not anymore in one institution, but between different organizations, which maybe are not anymore institutions. Maybe they call themselves still institutions, but after it's not anymore the security of the institution. They have to stay connected always, otherwise, like the boat, they fell off the net. That's the feeling also a lot of young artists especially have nowadays. So more and more the world becomes horizontal and wet. And we are surfing on it. That means also we can't touch the ground anymore. There's no depth anymore, or there's no time to go depth anymore. There's also no time to look at the sky. It's really this, chuk, 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 again and again. Why is this? I think it is connected with what I call three shifts, three historical shifts on a macro-sociological level. The first one is on a political level, which I call from, we could call it the shift from the welfare state to a neoliberal situation, or what I also called a post-political situation. Why do I call it post-political? Because the difference between left and right is blurring somewhere in this shift. Interesting is the shift happened from the 70s until 2000. Margaret Thatcher, Reagan comes in, etc. And we see it nowadays everywhere. I don't call it neoliberalism because it is not about new liberty at all. It is about a kind of regression of liberty, but I will come to this in a minute. Second evolution is on the shop floor, how we work. We see at the same time, in the 70s until 2000, the shift from what we call Fordism to post-Fordism. I will explain what this is about in 5 minutes. And interesting also, I think, starting from the 1980s, we don't call ourselves anymore modern art or modern artist, or we don't have anymore, we still have museums of modern art, but there comes also in the museums of contemporary art. So this is very interesting, I think. In the same time, we have a shift we have three shifts on three levels. I'm not a historian. I don't know what the connection is, but I see this kind of shifts at the same time, this kind of parallel histories. I mentioned a lot of the word post, and maybe you think, oh, now he's going to talk again about postmodernism. I know that postmodernism is shut down completely, I think, in the intellectual world nowadays. But in fact, I think we still live and in practice in a postmodern condition. That's my point with post. And I come to this later, what I mean by this. But all our institutions nowadays, how we function, are organized in a postmodern way. And we still have to deal with it. Even when it is shut down intellectually, we are still living in this kind of end of history story. I come to this. That's also end of history story, why it's called contemporary art. It's contemporary. It's only what now is important. It has no past, it has no future, in a way. It are those three macro-sociological shifts which I want to explain more in depth the coming 15 minutes. And I will relate it always to what, how does it affect an artistic career at the moment. And at the end, I will come up also how does it affect our teaching in this system. The first one, so the political shift, I explained already yesterday. I don't know if there are a lot of people of yesterday here. Some. Okay, sorry for them. I will explain again what is this about. This is the only same slide as yesterday. All the others are different. But of course, it's a macro-sociological shift, so it means it takes place everywhere. So also this shift I have to explain again. What is this about? I try to explain it by three quotes, but I try to do it also another way than yesterday for the people who were already yesterday here. I start with an anecdote nowadays, because I discovered repressive liberalism myself when I start working in the Netherlands. I'm Belgian, I live in Antwerp, and 10 years ago I went to the Netherlands to work there at the university, but also at an art school. It's called Fonte School for the Arts in Tilburg. And I get her the position of lecturer, as it's called in the Netherlands. Lecturer means not that you lecture, that's strange enough. In the Netherlands, it means that you are a research professor. So I had to bring in this school, research culture, PhDs, all things you do. That was my task in this school. It was a very high position, well paid. I got a huge office, enormous office. I came from a small university in Leuven in Belgium, and I came there. I said, oh, it was amazing. I got two plants. I got a design lamp, and I got, that was it. Okay, a serious research budget where I could make those books from. Anyway, I was so surprised for this anyway. After a month, I get the bill. So many rent you have to pay for the plants. So many for the design lamp. So many for each square meter of your office. I thought, what is this about? I went immediately to the director and I said, do I have to pay this all? Yeah, it goes from your working budget, of course, not from my fee. But anyway, everything is rationalized. Also, the sandwiches I eat, in meetings, the coffees I drink, everything was quantified in a way. I thought, okay, this is interesting. This is liberalism. This is free market system. So I went back to the director when I realized this. I said, the office in front of our school building is much cheaper. Can I go there and I take the money with? Ah, no, we have a European tenure. And then you see what repressive liberalism is about. You think you are a free market system, but at the same time, you're a very rigid bureaucratic system. And this is it about. It's a kind of very strange mixture of those two things. And that's why, for example, Hans Achterhuis said, while governments cut back everywhere and relegate tasks to the market, the supervisors who must guard the freedom of that market grow and grow and grow. So see this very strange kind of paradox, we see it. And I explained also yesterday how it happens nowadays also in art schools, universities, etc. At one side, governments say, organize your own educational program. Here's your bag of money and do it. But, of course, we organize quality control at a certain moment. And what is very interesting, what they did in the Netherlands, they didn't organize it central by state, they also privatized the control. So we have got a lot of companies, audit companies, offices, who do this kind of job. And I mentioned yesterday already, the last audit I had after 7 in 10 years in the Netherlands, this office was called Control. Because control is a brand. It means that you control holier than the Pope, and that you are sure, you're guaranteed that you get the money when you're controlled by them. That's the whole system. And this makes the system very rigid, but also very expensive. in a sense. The cost for those offices, etc., are very expensive. This is about this repressive liberalism. Sorry for repeating myself a little bit, but this is the only slide in which I repeat. And this took me think at a book which I've read when I was 19 years old, which I didn't understand at all, of Marcuse, who said, under the rule of a repressive whole, liberty can be made into a powerful instrument of domination. See the paradox. This is repressive liberalism about give people their individual freedom, make them all freelancers, and you have the best tool in your hands to have the political power in a central way. I think this is happening in our societies nowadays everywhere. And talk not only with people in art schools, when I talk with my neighbor who is a judge, she says the same things. Talk with surgeons in the hospital, they talk about the same things. It is about this. It is also about deprofessionalization. You have to fill in the form. You're always busy with those audits and accreditations and not anymore with your job and content at a certain moment. At least you have the feeling that you can still do research also, but in your free time. There you can do this. It becomes a kind of what we call, how the politicians called it in the Netherlands, a left hobby. This kind of research and artistic content-wise being busy. Anyway, this is what on the macro sociological level is an enormous shift. I think we saw. What does it do with this frame? You could foresee it already, and this may be a cliché, of course the market grows. But this is something already what we saw, I think, in the 70s. This was called or blamed as commodification of culture or commercial art, this kind of stuff. This does not interest me so much. What interests me much more is a kind of good quality of the market, which is exported to other fields and then becomes problematic. And this good quality is quantifying, learning to quantify yourself, learning to put your own qualities in quantity. And we get then, when this happens, what I call a kind of measurement obsession. You try to measure everything and you learn also to measure everything. For example, in the domestic space, creativity. When I was 4, 5 years old, I get a kind of white paper before me, I could do something. My son is on the iPod with drawing programs. But also when we interview, for example, architects, talk with them about designer programs. It's very interesting what it does with your creativity. Designer programs already calculate for you the risks which you could take and not can take. And so it starts already calculating before your creativity even. So that's what is also home entertainment, for example, in domestic fields doing. It is formatting creativity. It's calculating creativity. It's learning to quantify your creativity already before. So this is what we see in the domestic space. We see it also in art schools, for example. Peers get all those courses, arts management, culture management, creative industries, etc. And in a way, it's not a problem because artists have to learn to become much more, I think, an entrepreneur, to stand strong in the field. But it's very strange what people sometimes learn in those courses. I was in courses in the Fontes School of the Arts in Tilburg, where they have the famous Rock Academy, and they had their arts management, and they get also, the teacher get very blunt with again with a bag of money there, and says, you have to make more money of this. How can you do this? And then young rock stars all sitting there, I don't know. And then he says, okay, I will tell you, a pop song nowadays, no Deep Purple anymore, no 70 minutes, no, 4.5 minutes. 3 reference, no 10. in the pop song. Otherwise, it will not be played. It will get no airplay, also not, and it will not go on the radio. So you learn to format in those courses already what is fitting in the market. Of course, this was a bad teacher. Anyway, but this is the you learn to quantify also in this place your own practices already in the peers. This is important already in the peers. Cultural industries, Guggenheim Bilbao. We all know it's in the cultural policy plans of Guggenheim Bilbao, 80% dead artists. Otherwise, they can't get the targets of public. So they count exactly how much artists, dead artists, they need to make their exhibitions and to make it runnable. You see this also in small museums in Groningen, where I work. You see this Groninger Museum. They have one time they have a very interesting experimental artist, and the other 3 weeks is David Bowie. This guy, chuk, chuk, chuk. So you see they're counting. They're really counting, and the program is already pre-counted. So this is interesting. I think we learn to count, but also in other fields where you, most of, I think better not count sometimes. But anyway, so this is happening. Interesting is when you look at more economical and political theory about this. This whole system is not something which hangs somewhere in the air, which is called neoliberalism or something like that. It is invented. It is. Empirically studied. It was done in the 70s in Chicago by the Chicago Boys, it's called. It's described very beautiful in the book The Shock Doctrine of Naomi Klein. And they developed this whole system of quantifying and learning to quantify yourself, learning to quantify institutions like hospitals. And they explain also why it's good. They experiment with this whole model in Child of Pinochet to try it out. And then they try to explore it to other places. For example, literally when the war in Iraq started, first the American soldiers went there. A month later, the economics were there to bring democracy to Iraq. But it was, in fact, to implement this kind of free market system in general in other spheres. This is, for me, important. In other spheres, it's not that free market is a bad thing or something like that. It is to organize almost whole society like that. And you could guess that's why they are mixed. This is a very hybrid space where practices also for artists are mixed. In a very strange way. At least, again, they are individualized there. You are the one who puts the border between things. Anyway, this is happening, again, on the macro-sociological level. Let's go in the second shift, what I talked about. So we had the political shift from politics to post-politics, or from welfare state to what I call repressive liberalism. The second shift is on the shop floor, where we work from Fordism to post-Fordism. I think everybody knows where Fordism stands for. Yeah, Henry Ford, car builder kind of system. Interesting is that he made material projects. You can touch them. But especially what is important for a good product in such a system is use value. A good car is a car which can drive from point A to B. That's a good car. It were all black cars, all those T models we all know. So standard products, but that was not important at all. What was important is that they could drive from point A to B. Also, a good raincoat is a raincoat which helps you against the rain. That's a good raincoat. So you get standard products, and very important in this system is product economy. That means the producer decides how it looks like, how it is made, etc. What interests me as a sociologist more is, of course, what happens on the shop floor. On the shop floor, we see high immobility. People work sometimes for 40 years next door in the factory. They every day go to the same place
putting this tire in the car and go home again after 8 hours. You had fixed working hours, even when you worked in shifts, you had a kind of fixed of 9 to 5 or 6 to 2 or something like that. And very important in the system is working is doing. You need to do something, otherwise you are not working. So even putting this always this tire in the car is doing something. So don't talk. And it's very interesting in the system. I was some months ago in an old Philips factory in Eindhoven in the Netherlands, where still stood this slogan: "People are working here. Don't speak." Because speaking disturbs you in this system. You have to. It's not when you communicate. It can disturb you even when you put a tire in the car. So doing is the work ethos also of the system. This shifts also in the 70s, where immaterial products become more and more important. So it's not only about use value anymore, but also about sign value. You buy a car because not only because it can drive from point A to B, but because it has a nice color, a nice design, etc. So immaterial things come in. You also buy, for example, a cell phone because there are new applications, not because it doesn't ring anymore. So sign value becomes important, and this is a kind of consumer economy. This means that now the producer is going to listen very well to what consumers want. And they sit around the table talking about a bottle of shampoo, for example. How does it look like? How do we have to design, etc. So it is orientated in a way to the consumer. So accountability becomes very important in this economic system. You want to foresee what consumer wants at a certain moment. So that's why you have those kind of test, pre-test researches in it. And you work at the end not anymore with standard products, but with coded products. You compose your own cell phone. This is, of course, only possible in a digitalized world where you can. But there are still standard products, but there are coded products in which you give you the feeling that you can identify it yourself. Give it your own identity, I mean by that. Again, for me, it's much more interesting what happens on the shop floor. You get this immature label, high mobility. I think the sociologist of mobility, John Urry, counted in 1999, so before Ryanair, before EasyJet, etc., how many people were in 99 in the air at one moment? 40 million, one small nation state is flying around, still at that moment. So high mobility, a lot of trains ticked full of people, traffic jams, etc., is a kind of result of this. But also high mobility in that sense that people only work most of the time, plus minus, I think, 7 years at the same place, and then shift to another employer. You get also flexible working hours, but also even liquid working hours. You can work at night. I can answer mails from my students at night. They can phone me on my mobile when I'm on holiday. So there is no border anymore in an institutionalized way between private and public work. Communication becomes important. Talking, talking, talking. Making PowerPoints, showing IDs. This is working nowadays, communication. So virtuosity and language becomes very important. This is, and also the capacity of detachment, that you can jump from one project to another and immediately get involved in another context and understand this context. So high mobility. When you look at what was Fordism about, this is the picture of Charlie Chaplin, we all know Modern Times, I think. Nowadays, post-Fordism looks like this. We are still connected with a machine, and not most of the time, but we are also get horizontal more and more while we work. But what is more interesting, you don't know what she is doing. Is this free time? Is she on Facebook? Or is she answering mails of her students, for example? Or is she working on Facebook? can be also self-promotion at a certain moment for their own job, etc. So this is more and more the condition in which everybody, I think, nowadays lives. This is post-Fordism. And also, there is no factory anymore. You live, you can work everywhere, at home, in bed, at any moment. Okay, going back, what does this mean, again, for this kind of scheme? It's interesting what happens when the market grows and takes over those other fields. At a certain moment, there comes a kind of very strange feedback on the market itself. And it is a little bit what Adam Smith already foresaw. For example, my son of 9 years old knows perfect how to manipulate programs, how to download illegal things, etc. Piracy comes in. And it's very interesting. It's a very creative way between creativity and criminality to develop completely new things on the internet with formatted things, and you try to change those formats again. But piracy, we all know, is very bad for a well-working free market. It hollows out, in a way, or blocks even the system of a free market. Creative industries put very intelligent, creative mathematicians in the center of the financial system, and you get creative banking. You get 2008. So when you put artists in such systems, you get big problems. This is what happened, I think, in 2007, 2008. It is that we really believe in creativity in a way, and this kind of derivatives were composed of very strange financial products in a very creative way, but they are completely virtual, of course, but they affect what we call the real economy, and it's bad for the free market working. So also in that sense, we get a kind of very strange effect or feedback on the market. The same counts for cultural industries. For example, let majors in pop music negotiate with the government to make their own laws, what happened in the United States, and you get what we have nowadays, three majors only who determine the field of pop music nowadays. Every festival looks the same when you go to an international pop music festival. Why is it? Because we only have three majors. So you get monopolies again, which is bad for the free market itself. Or you get Bill Gates. It's the same problem. So the monopolization, because you have power and you have enormous influence on this in this civil field. Again, I put it there to some names just to show also this system was invented. It was really thought about it, how to build up, and it is written down how this world can function by Ayn Rand. Atlas Shrugged, somebody knows this book of it. It's a kind of novel, philosopher, 1950s, philosopher, novel writer, 1950s in the United States. Well, Atlas Shrugged describes the world in which everything is quantified. So also even your love relationship is quantified. You ask money for sex in a love relationship. That's a good love relationship in this kind of novel she describes. But this novel is the best read and sold book in the United States still beyond the Bible. So still it has enormous influence. And this Ayn Rand lived together for a long time with Alan Greenspan. Alan Greenspan was the man until 2008 in charge of the Federal Reserve in the United States. So he was really in political power also and economical power to develop this program. And he writes also how he introduces this whole program with the help of the Chicago boys in this system. Anyway, so I'm not talking about ghosts or something like that. It is reality. It is organized, and people are busy with organizing those kind of programs everywhere. And we copy it nowadays everywhere. I see in the Netherlands that the system is copied. So it's not a belief in efficiency, etc. It is really a kind of economical model of, sorry, that's my phone, economical model of which is developed at the universities and which they tried out in society. Anyway, you have this feedback nowadays, and I think this is the condition in which we live now. There we are. We have a very strange situation. Also, in which the market itself doesn't know anymore. It is really working, malfunctioning in a way, or dysfunctioning in a way. And yeah, that's the condition in which I think we live. How now does this affect our creative labor? Creative labor becomes more and more in this kind of post-Fordist condition, a kind of exchange or economy of ideas. That, what I mean by this, an idea has value, has economical value in this system. Like a design can have economical value. You buy a cell phone because of the design also. It still has the ring, but also because of the design. So you come in a situation in which you deal and sell ideas. But ideas is something very ephemeral. You can't touch it, an idea. So I was very interested, how does this work in the artistic field? How do people deal with that, designers, etc.? So my research was about interviewing boards of biennials. And I asked boards, why do you choose this curator for this biennial, but I also interviewed curators of biennials and asked them, why do you choose this artist for this biennial at this moment? The same thing we did a little bit for art festivals and performing arts and music also. But especially it was interesting what the answers were of those people. Sometimes the answers were about name and fame. We choose this curator because when we choose him, we attract a lot of people, etc. But it's not always like that. Sometimes they also, in an honest way, work with young curators and want to give them chances, etc. So it's not only about name and fame. Is it that they choose them because they are good managers? Most of the time, they are not. The curators are not good organizers. They are very inefficient in doing things, and people know this. This is mostly not a reason why they are chosen. But when they are chosen for good reasons, so I mean not for political reasons or not for economical, for example, tourist reasons or something like that to attract people, but when they are really honestly chosen in an integral sense, then they are chosen because a board hopes that they bring a good idea. So this is the main thing, the central figure in this kind of cultural economy, that you bring a good idea. But what is a good idea nowadays? A good idea is still, when you ask them, a new idea. You have to come with something new, innovative, otherwise it's not good. So a good idea is certainly a new idea. You have to bring something new. That's a very modern way of thinking about what you should do in this cultural field, coming up with something new. But, and this comes in much more, I think, in the 70s, 80s, a new idea is not good enough. Because nowadays, for example, you cannot copy the same exhibition from New York in Istanbul. They shoot you as a young professional curator. You have to come up with an exhibition which is related to the context. So you change a little bit your new idea, which you did in New York, and you relate it to the context in Istanbul, for example. You look at the economical, artistic scene, the ecological sometimes context, political context, and you relate an exhibition to that. So you have to come up also more and more with an appropriate ID. And that's also why we see that a lot of curators, but also artists, when they, before they make a kind of context-related installation art at a certain place, that they have followed the methodology of interviewing people. They test their ID, their new ID, again and again, and they look how it can fix in a certain context. So you get more and more what I call opportunistic IDs, but opportunistic not in a moral sense, it's opportunistic in the sense that you take the opportunities of the context in which you make a work of art, or you make an exhibition, or you work as a programmer for a festival, etc. So a good ID is not only anymore a new ID, it's also more and more becoming an appropriate ID. It has to be related to the context. But still then, it's a very complex economy, because how can you know that a curator you invited will come with a good ID? You can't foresee this. So the only thing what is contracted in this whole world, when there are contracts at all, are in fact the promise of a good ID what is contracted. It's very ephemeral. So you don't buy an exhibition you made there and let no, you buy the promise of a good ID to make a good exhibition which is related to the context at this moment and place. So it's a very ephemeric trait what you have there, because you don't know how if they come to it. So this is very important. This is the core, I think, of post-Fordism and immaterial label, that a promise is capitalized. And you see this also in, for example, commercial creative labor. Why is, for example, a designer contracted for a kind of commercial company who makes commercials? Because they still hope that he or she will come with new good ideas. And there are, of course, tricks. You can look at what he or she did in the past, the portfolio. But in fact, you never know. Maybe he or she had a burnout. She's done with it. You never know. So it's a guess. It's a bet if you come up. So this is, I think, more and more the world in which we live in now, as creatives, but even as academics, intellectuals who work with intellectual work, I mean, in all the fields in which ideas become the central, even in the financial world, where ideas become center of our core business of dealing with each other. So we come in the context of competition of ideas, so we have to organize also this world in a completely different way than the old Fordist factory to let make it efficient. And how do we organize it nowadays? We organize it like this, like a scene. The scene is the factory nowadays, the fashion scene, the visual art scene, the theater scene, etc. This is the new factory, how we organize work. I took here a picture of the opening of the Biennial of Venice. This is Michelangelo Pistoletto, who is breaking the mirrors, which is, by the way, a very clever picture. It was in the front page of even the New York Times when the Biennial opened, and I was wondering why it's not so sensational, this picture of an art piece. Why could it be in so many? It was a lot of newspapers in the front page. It's very interesting, and I thought about this picture. Well, the reason is because of those people who are picturing themselves in the mirror. So you look at an event which gives attention enormously to itself. The media photographs itself while it is photographing. And that, by doing this, you say, this is an important event. So this is how also media constructs media events in a general sense. So Michelangelo Pistolato played with this kind of wedding. And of course, he breaks then the mirror. But anyway, that's the anecdote. It's nothing to do with this. But this is a typical event of on the scene. The scene where people gather, opening parties of exhibitions, the premieres of theater pieces, where you have a good drink, the reception, etc. And more we see also on an economical level, this scene is promoted by guys like Richard Florida, for example. Books like The Rise of the Creative Class, but also Know Your City, are books which are involved in this. And I mentioned yesterday already, we did a little bit of research in the Netherlands for all the communities, so not only cities, but also small communities, community governments. And we analyzed their cultural policy plans in 2009. And what came out was that only two community governments did not mention the name of Richard Florida. So even a small town with 8,000 inhabitants like Venlo has creative industries and a creative scene because they have a brass band. So this is the whole myth about this kind of creative industry. So I don't blame Richard Florida, but it's very interesting how bureaucrats and policymakers use this whole fantasy of a creative scene and really believe in this kind of creative scenes. You need to have an creative scene in your city to stay on an economical level nowadays. That's the, at least the rhetorics. And for example, in Amsterdam in the 90s, they went to look at Berlin to how to do it. And then they tried to copy it in Amsterdam, this kind of, strange places. They build it also in the city where I work, Groningen, which is in fact a very small. They literally build a kind of creative district in it, and after 5 years it was completely done. It's very strange, but in a very artificial way people think you can manage this kind of creativity and you can give it a place in society. This is the Richard Florida hype. What interests me much more is what is this scene about? How does it function? As a sociologist, I'm looking at it. And then I, for understanding what a scene was, I looked back to my study book of the first year in sociology and try to look at definitions of social figurings. And one is like a group. What is a group? A group has membership. Well, a scene has not membership. You can go in the scene and also easily go out. So it's not a group, a scene. It's also not a subculture like punk movement, listening to the same music, the same clothes. We could maybe say visual art field in the, especially until the 80s, had the same look like Michelangelo Pistoletto, all in black, but not certainly not as white hat and black glasses. But this is over, I think. It's difficult to identify the culture of a scene, but it has a culture. It has an identity. When you fly from Tokyo, Tokyo to New York, from New York to Brussels, or to Helsinki, you immediately know, no, I'm on the scene. You recognize it. So it has a kind of identity, but not so fixed as a subculture. So it's also not a category. A category has no identity at all. All the Helsinki women of 18 years old, for example, that's a category. They have no self-identity. A scene has. You can recognize a scene. So what is the scene about? What is interesting at the scene, what I said already, you see scenes everywhere. So you can fly from one scene to another. So scenes organize, in a way, a kind of home. I call it a kind of urban intimacy. You feel immediately, when you are a professional in the visual arts field, at home when you arrive at a scene, in a way. You just have to say, let's say 1 year ago, the name Damien Hirst, and you have immediately a chat on the scene, or a serious intellectual discussion. So you share, in a way, a reference frame which makes you feel home, even when you are in Tokyo, in Helsinki, or in Brussels. This is a very interesting thing what the scene organizes for you. Feeling at home everywhere in the world, at certain places, at certain spots. So, This is what the scene is doing. It's mixing also domestic and working space. It is, in a way, like I said before, what is the scene? It's not only the museum, it's not only the theater, it's also the opening of, and especially the pubs around and the restaurants around, where you meet. There the assignments are made. The contracts are also made. No, mostly the contracts are signed the day after under neon lights, but you get the assignment at the opening of an exhibition, etc. So what is happening in this place? The scene is organizing this very interesting mixture between informal and formal life, professional and domestic life. When we interviewed, for example, artists, but especially curators, in the beginning, when I start to interview them, I was always stuck because they mentioned so many friends. They say, my friend Boris Groys, my friend this, my friend that. So, oh, they have so many friends. And when you listen to them, really, sometimes it were really friends, but sometimes it were also just people you know in a professional way. And there's a big gray zone between those two. And this is very interesting, because it's really how it functions, this kind of informality, formality, etc. So, but this mixture is very important, because you get assignments there. We know this from a study of young designers, for example, in London. The research was about that they had to fill out a diary. They had to keep it with them for a month or something like that, and they had to describe the time they spent for their work, etc. 40% of the time they were busy being seen on the scene. You need to be seen on the scene, otherwise you're not on the scene. So to get assignments, etc. And especially what this study also, this research shows, is that a young woman above 32 fell out. They get no assignments anymore in this design district, or lesser and lesser. Why? Because they cannot be on the scene anymore when they get children, etc. So this is a very interesting thing, that being a performer and being seen on the scene becomes part of your professional life. It's working time at this place where those things are mixed. But the scene does still something else, which is very important for an economy of ID. It controls and regulates also this whole economy. Because what is the scene organizing for you in this kind of exchange of IDs? There's one rule you never do when you exchange IDs and you live from your IDs. It is, you never exchange your ID between four eyes. There always have to be a witness when you say, I think this could be an interesting concept for an exhibition, because otherwise somebody can steal your ID. And stealing is the biggest gossip, of course, in this whole thing. But it is, of course, it is because an ID has economical value and also symbolical value in this whole system. So being seen on the scene while you are exchanging IDs is very important. It's part of also your professional life. And very interesting is this control is not anymore state control, central control, or something like that. It is we control each other in our professionality. And that's also what the scene is organizing. The scene is, in a way, organizing a flat network of interaction. But, sorry, that's not so clear what is standing there. The scene gives you the feeling that you are free, you are in those leisure places, pubs, etc. But this makes you work. So it's kind of the inverse of the Nazi camp. It's Freiheit macht Arbeit and not Arbeit macht frei. It is really because you feel that you are free, it makes you work. And this is really the condition of the freelancer nowadays. You need to be there to get assignments at a certain moment. One young theater maker we interviewed, and it's very interesting, emotional, how she explained how it works for her at a certain moment. And it's a small anecdote, but it makes it very clear. what is this about? She told the situation that she went after a theater piece, theater performance, to the pub where you need to be as an she was an actress. And I asked her, what do you do then when you are there at such places in such a pub? And she said, yeah, you just drink a wine or something like that. But then you meet this director and that director, and this director says, I'm busy with an interesting project, maybe something for you. And then you exchange business cards. You say, yes, I will mail you about it. I will clarify it tomorrow or something like that. What happens then? Then she goes home, she told me. And the day, even the evening, when she comes home, she opens her mailbox and looks at, did he mail me? He didn't mail. The day after, she opens again and says, no mail. Third day, no mail. And then she starts thinking about, okay, maybe I said something wrong on the spot. Or maybe somebody else said something wrong about me. Or the worst case scenario, maybe there is somebody better who can do the job than me. I'm replaceable. There's nothing worse than the feeling that you're replaceable as a creative, authentic worker. And this is the real, this is the feeling a lot of people have, kind of mental statement, which I call back hysteria. Hysteria is completely back in this cultural field, but not only in this cultural field, also in the academic field. I see a lot of colleagues of mine who are mentioning every 3 months on a staff meeting, oh, this university get this research grant. We didn't. What do we have to do? So this kind of hysteria comes in again in a very, very strange way. And then you get, of course, change management. People, oh, we have to change the whole program because we have to get more students. We are losing students to Amsterdam. How can we do with this? This kind of hysteria comes in everywhere. And you see it also even at state level. This multinational wants to move to China. Oh, what do we have to do? We have to do tax reductions, etc. So you get a kind of historical, hysteria policy on all the levels. Global level, you have it on meso level organizations like institutions, and you have it on the individual level. I think this is really the also kind of mental state. More and more we are back in this kind of hysteric way of operating. And this is really related also to the whole system of freelancers. I mentioned yesterday already to somebody, individual, somebody knows where this word comes from, freelancer. Yes. What's the origin of it?
I mean, you're using the lance, you're free.
Yeah, okay. It comes from 2,000 years ago, the samurai, the free lance. People with a free lance who you could rent. For the best bidder, and they fight for the best bidder. You all know such a freelancer, somebody who's hired to fight, has better not a political opinion for who he fights. He fights for the best bidder. So he's better not related today, not with the union. He's a very weak political animal. Right? So this freelancer, is something very tricky. And this is how economy, but also especially creative work, nowadays is more and more organized. I mentioned yesterday already the example that in the Netherlands in 2009, only 2,000 people get a fixed contract for life anymore. All the rest is more and more freelancer. They're stimulating this freelance status. But again, it makes you very weak. Also in a political sense, and I have nothing against freelancers, that's not a thing. It is a kind of very weak statistical position almost in professional life. Okay, this is some rhetorics of one book, The Murmuring. My hypothesis is, in fact, this whole system, this how economy is organized in a social way in the art field. This art field was already organized like that in the 19th century, and it was, in fact, the library of other economies. we copied it. Also, the financial world copied it from the art world, of course, in a very selective, way. Okay. Now, this is the situation, I think, again, in nowadays, in which we work as creative workers. And now I go really to statistics. We ask people, how do you respond to this art situation? We did interviews. This was based on an interview we did only in Belgium and in the Netherlands with alumni of only visual autonomous art schoolers. Who finished their studies between 1975 and the last one was 2005. So we make a kind of cohort analysis of them. We interviewed people, students who finished their studies so in 1975 and the last one 2005. And we asked them the same questions again. How do you build up a career? How can you develop in a sustainable way your creativity? And how do you respond on the actual situation of the art world nowadays? I start with the last one. 18.2% said, I stop. I do completely something else. So 18.2% of people who intended to become autonomous visual artists said, it's nothing for me. And sometimes they decided already when they are in school, right, that they want to do something else. Interesting is that 24.3% are also stopped. They don't make art anymore, but they do art-related work. That means that they become a curator, critic. In this field, or sometimes arts managers also for other artists, or they do the logistics of successful artists. So they do art-related work, but they also learn to work more and more what we call the project city. They learn to shift from one project to another, develop projects, and in a way they safeguard also the artists who cannot do that. And who cannot do this are the other group, the monoliths. The monoliths is a shrinking group over the years. We saw this 80.1% still in the total sample. It are people who only do their autonomous work in their studio and make a living. Also, try to make a living of this. Interesting is the strategy they use to keep this kind of place to make their work autonomous, and they use what we called a space strategy. What we mean by that is, in the studio, they do their work and nobody comes in. When they are out of the studio, they can negotiate with commercial dealers, with museum directors, creators, so they are another person. So they use the vision between the studio, the place there, and outside as a kind of also mental border to make this kind of borders again between those fields which I showed before. They use space, mental in their head, to make this kind of distinction. But it's a shrinking group. They are also not, it's very interesting, they are also complete, they hate socializing, networking. It's for example, we interviewed yeah, maybe you know him, but he was very famous in the 1980s. It's Thierry Decordier, it's a Belgian visual artist. And he mentioned in this interview, the social will be the dead of you. So he hated to be on the spot. Also, it's a typical 1980s, I think, picture of the artist, always in black. And when there's an opening of exhibition, he's standing there in the corner and talking to nobody. And the other do the talking. The arts manager, for example, commercial gallery owner, etc. So this is a typical kind of attitude also of a lot of artists. Anyway, it's a shrinking group. Then we have 28.3%, a growing group. We call it, with a very ugly word, the plural active artist. That means plural active, that he combines jobs. But he makes a kind of very strict distinction between those practices. He does, or she does, autonomous art at a certain moment, and makes also commercial design, for example, at another moment. Interesting again is they use in their head a mental strategy to make this division and this time. They say, for example, Monday and Tuesday I do autonomous art, and the rest of the week I do my commercial work, or I even teach or do other things. So plural active means that you are combining a lot of things, but you make the strict distinction between those for yourself. Commercial work is not my autonomous work. It's completely something different, and you try to make this distinction. It's a growing group, and also a growing group is the last one, and that's what we call hybrid artist. What's the hybrid artist? It's not somebody who is combining things. The hybrid artist is doing the same things, but he is selling it for other things. What do I mean by that? We have a good example in the Netherlands called Joep van Lieshout, an artist. He makes things, for example, it looks like a statue or architecture, and he says to the world, you decide. Is it autonomous art? Okay, the museum can have it. Is it architecture? Okay, you can get it with an assignment. Or is it design? Okay, I sell it at a design fair or something like that. So he makes the same products, but the same products are hybrid because they can be different things, or they can work in different networks. Of course, this shows, this sounds very pink or something like that, or romantic. What Joep van Lieshout is doing is managing where an object comes. He's networking again and again in a very social way. So the social is definitely not a dead of him. The social is the core business, what he is doing. He's dealing again and again to get objects in a certain network at a certain moment, in the museum, or design, or architecture, etc. And that's the hybrid artist for us. Right? That's how we define. So it is not about interdisciplinarity. It's not about combining practices. No, it's in fact doing the same practices, but selling it in different networks, or putting it in different networks, like a hybrid car, which can drive on fuel and on electricity, for example. Same object can be both things, or several things. And they are managing this. That's the, again, the hybrid artist. But those in this research are all individual responses of individual artists to the art system nowadays. Interesting for me to question is, are there also possibilities of collective responses to this? Can we respond or react on it in a different way? Back to the scheme, yes, we can, but it is also, I said, I will do also a little bit speculative thinking or utopic thinking. It's maybe the future. I think you can organize also in a collective way, a completely different way of operating in this system, and that is by trying to bring what I call, not I call, a lot of people call it fairly fashionable nowadays, the commons in place. For example, making in a marketplace itself things for free again. We see this with Lawrence Lessig, defender of Creative Commons, for example, who invented also this whole rule system of Creative Commons, trying to make things for free again. Why is this important? A lot of artists say, it is necessary for me that I can come to places where I can use things again, without filling in a form, but also without paying, without it, because I don't have the money to pay for it. So it is this Creative Commons, or commons in general also, is not getting things for free like free beer. It's getting things free like free speech. You can use it again in a free way. But it is also a possibility to organize this in the domestic space. Think at Wikipedia, for example. But also, even my son is using very strange computer programs he downloads somewhere, which manipulates other things, etc. And he builds up a kind of common law in the domestic space at home. And I think what is important in the peers is talking, for example, in art schools again about politics. Why do we have to become a cultural entrepreneur? What are the advantages, but also the disadvantages of calling yourself an entrepreneur? Are there alternatives? That's politics. Politics doesn't mean party politics for me. Politics is about, literally means giving form to society, giving form also to your own profession, your own role in society. That's politics about, and reflection about this. So those things, at one hand, are happening already, I think. We see this Creative Commons, we see the gardens in the cities building up, etc., at several places. But I think it can be developed more and more, and it can be also only, I think, developed because it is pushed by civil society. Not only governments, for me, stand civil society. It means really people who organize themselves things. I think, for example, related to government, the whole idea of thinking about cooperatives again. So not on the individual level, but organizing creative labor in cooperatives. When you look at the rules, the laws about labor in the Netherlands especially, you see this freelancer is stimulated enormously in the law system, etc., but not cooperatives. So it is also this fight about making things common as possible. So the common is certainly not a kind of romantic place where you get like paradise, where you get everything for free. It's a place of dissensus, fight for things. It's also a place where a hybrid place where private and state companies sometimes clash, but also work together sometimes. So it's a very strange place. And again, it's you as an individual who have to decide in a tactical way almost how you can develop here things. Okay, so just to respond to some artists we interviewed in the past, or I get from artists, but this one we interviewed. I think it's very important not to make, in a way, political art. It can be. It can be interesting, I think. You see a lot of artists, for example, responding, I think at Oliver Ressler, for example, responding to neoliberalism, capitalism, etc. And this kind of radical politics is also very fashionable nowadays when you go to biennials and festivals and debates, etc. And I think sometimes it's interesting, so that's not my point. You can make political art, but it's more important, I think, to think about to make art politically, as Thomas Hirschhorn says. And what he means by this is trying to define the spaces and how you make your art in a different way. And then it becomes really political, even when it is a white square painting. It is where you show it, at which place, and how you do it there. Where you can literally make space again. And while you're doing this, you are also making at the same time the commons again. When you're open this space. So it's much more about thinking about where do I position my art, at which moment, and how do I do it there. And this is separate of what you make and what the message of your work is. And I think another important one is Thierry Geoffroy. I always said the name wrong. I think the contemporary is over. So the whole condition of the contemporary art, which has no future and also no past, and that's why it has no future, it's over, it's done. It is this kind of flatness and circle in which we work now, in which a lot of artists are important because they show this the lowest at a certain moment, but have no time frame anymore. It is really important, I think, to think about what is emergent and what do we need to do in society at the moment as an artist. So this means also in society, not only related to all the biennials and the documentas, etc. It really means of what can I do as a position at a certain moment in the political, economical context. Okay, I know it's a long lecture. Is it, I can go on here? Yeah? Because now I jump to education.
Will you take a 5-minute break?
It's what you want. Yeah? Okay, yeah.
To get a cup of coffee and do
a couple. Yeah, I just have 4 slides or so.
Yeah, we'll try.
Yeah. And trust that everybody is back in 10 minutes. But I didn't say that.
Very interesting. You want a coffee?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, this
how do you define it?
You said that the hybrid part is sort of doing the same thing over and over again, but selling it in 2 different contexts.
Mm-hmm.
How do you then define hybrid that actually starts and so needs to work to start disciplinary or multiple contexts? That applies his or her.
Yeah. So how does a certain peers at a certain moment look at my work?
Am I being seen as a sort of a legitimate artist?
Mm-hmm.
I can do that, but I can't go there.
So
I don't know. Ah. Okay, let's start again. I only have, I think, 3 or 4 slides done, but I want to jump in. I want to say also something about relationship between education and.
And this attitude
of artist, how you can. Is it working? Is it not working? I don't know. Okay. Yeah. What's happening with art schools and teaching nowadays? We made 2 books about it. One was written, I think, in 2011, I think. Teaching Art in the Neoliberal Realm. And I finished one last year, which is called Teaching Art Beyond Art, or something like that. So what I say now is based on those 2 books, and also on the time gap between those 2 books. Let's start with the first book and our observations in art schools when I was walking there in the Fonda School of Arts in Tilburg and registering what was happening there in the school. I just say the situation of the school because it sounds probably very familiar to you. This was a school which was built of in fact 12 art schools, fusion, merging together. Famous rock academy with conservatory, architecture, we had everything, dance in it, etc. So you get a huge restructuring of a school. And then I arrived there. I get my job at that moment when this all was happening, and I had to bring their research culture as a research professor. But in fact, to be honest, the first 4 years I worked there, I could do almost nothing because they were organizing and reorganizing and reorganizing again. So I stood there somewhere. I had my beautiful office. You all know now about it. But I didn't know. I could not. For example, when I started negotiations with one director of those schools, which had one general director, but to deal with about 3 months later, there was another director. So there was really, I didn't could catch even the whole thing and understand it at that moment. So that's the moment when I decided, okay, no, I'm going to make books. Bye-bye. And who wants to be involved can be involved. And we do it like that. And I invited individual teachers, of course, etc., to do this. But I make my own club or something like that in this art school at that moment. But this whole situation also made me think about what is happening here. Why is this 1,600 students together in one place? Do they have to become all artists? Help. How many schools do we have like this in the Netherlands? Do they all pretend to become an artist? And do we give them this pretension also in this art school, etc. So I try to find out where does it come from. And I explained to you already repressive liberalism, so I don't have to explain it again what this means. But what you saw in the Netherlands, and that's what I call the Bologna effect. I think everybody knows Bologna. Yeah. Effect. What does this do with schools at a certain moment? We know all know that, in fact, the beautiful picture of Bologna is that it organizes schools in whole Europe in a kind of standard way that you can exchange, that I can come to teach here, but also students can come. That's a beautiful idea. I think bachelor master system, it functions. But when you do this, when you make schools also in a way equal in organization structure, they become also competitors of each other. You can choose as I go to this one, I go to that one, etc. So schools become more and more defined in a market as a company, and they have to compete with other schools for students. So schools are more and more defining themselves as a kind of private company in this situation. And even the relationship between teachers and students is defined more and more as a kind of contract relationship. Again, an anecdote, the general director of the Swanton School of the Arts in the Netherlands had reserved the last 2 weeks of, the first 2 weeks of June just for phoning with lawyers. Because then parents, especially of students, start to fight with lawyers, their diploma, that they don't get the grades, etc., etc. And it's a very strange thing, but that's really how students more and more define themselves also in relationship with it. You get a service here, and I pay for this service, so I get it. That's a contract relationship. And more and more students define this, and it's very, it's very, I laughed a lot, and I enjoyed that the director, general director, also could laugh at it. He hated it, of course, those 2 weeks, but he knew it already. And he said, oh, for example, an anecdote was a whole discussion about a dancer with the lawyer was that at least she said that she could lay her leg at the right level. But the teacher said, you never will become a dancer because you don't have it in your body. But she said, but I passed, I could lay my leg on the right level, as you asked. So they try also to rationalize this kind of relationship, which definitely in art schools is very subjective. This is, of course, an extreme. It only happened once, and we laughed a lot of it, and they lost the whole thing. But anyway, this is kind of how, in the mental state, more and more students see the relationship. So, and the student is also, we mentioned this already, more and more defined as an entrepreneur. And also, I was involved. They are also defining themselves more and more as a kind of researcher who has to manage some targets, has to report also these targets, etc. So this is one effect also of Bologna, that schools, in fact, define themselves more and more in a kind of market situation as a kind of private company. Second thing, which I was totally the witness of, is increase of scale. They try to reduce costs. Management comes in and they try to standardize everything. But also, again, there it is, they try to quantify everything. How much competences do you deliver your students? What do they have to learn? And you have to fill in the firm ambitions. How much contact hours do you have? In the first place, you think, it's to protect me. I have only so much contact hours. But at a certain moment, you see that it doesn't work. And you're much more busy with filling in the contact hours than having contact with your students. This is the whole thing. So this standardization brings a lot of paperwork. And brings also in the organization what I call deprofessionalization. You have to do something else than your profession, teaching in a well, and you get huge centralization of things. Standardization is also, it's hilarious, for example, how do you call it? I'm looking for the good English word, I think. You have somebody central in this Swanton school, but also at the university, who makes the schedules of rooms you use, for example. Which time do we use this room here at a certain moment? But it's very funny when this happens at an art school where students are in a rehearsal of a theater piece, and every 50 minutes they have to move from one room to another while they were rehearsing and taking their kind of decor with them, etc., because it's centralized, organized, and the central scheduler is somebody who doesn't know what an art school is about. He or she does it also for nursery schools, he does it for everything. So you get a huge standardization, and of course then again negotiation. No, you don't do it like this, etc., this kind of system. But in schools itself, you see a growing neo-management, what I call it, so a kind of new management, and they of course, because it are such big institutions, they need to government at a distance, centralized and well organized. But they try to do it in a very personal way. And when you are manage at a distance and you want to measure quality, for example, you have to develop systems to measure this quality, and that's why you get this kind of assessments again and again, not only organized in an official way by the government, but also by the management itself, a kind of pre-assessment in your school. And that's why those schools are more and more involved in what he has his name with him, Michael Porrow calls it the audit society. In a society in which we audit again and again and again. And what is interesting about audits is that you already anticipate to audits. You describe already, you try to describe your practice about what the next audit will be. For example, in the Sfondo School of Arts, say, oh, now the audits, they will definitely look at how we test the examinations. So what do we, we have to do more multiple choice because that's, and we have to do, so you anticipate the content already, which you bring to this audit format. Very interesting was the discovery when you look at this, that when we were preparing our examinations for the next audit, also in hospitals, they were doing the same things with the same targets. Surgeons were also thinking about how can we better improve some surgeons and how can we describe this. And again, my neighbor lawyer was doing the same to prove that she judges well in the court. So you see a kind of, this is a very strange thing, you see completely different organizations like museums, art schools, law systems, maybe even parliament, I don't know. But anyway, see doing, anticipating to the same fiction because they foresee that they will look at that at this moment. So they anticipate to this audit. Where the, and this brings kind of enormous homogenization of completely different organizations in it, how they act, and but also how they are reported in media. What is a good hospital? A good hospital has so many patients a year served well. A good school, so many students get a diploma at this school. So it is also the whole fiction that you can measure this quality in a kind of equal way between different institutions. Audit society. You get this kind of whole system of personal evaluation. What is personal evaluation? I don't know if you have it. Most of the time I have to do it once or two times a year. One is called a contract talk or something like that. Another one is an evaluation. What do you do in this contract talk? You say to him, what do you think you will manage this year? Put on your personal, please, your personal targets. Of course, when you do this, you can measure. You say, you didn't well at the end because you didn't manage what you wanted to do at this certain moment. So it is trying to manage, this is very important, trying to manage very much on the individual level. So you stay at a distance, that's new management about, but you develop formats and forms especially to fill out to measure the qualities and especially the quantities of your people or your staff on an individual level. This is what, and I know it's a heavy word, but this is what Michel Foucault already called biopolitics. It is not only measuring, it's not only measuring your profession and what you can do as a professor and what your skills are, it's measuring bios, your whole life. It's measuring, it's also asking the question in this personal evaluations, that's why they call personal, how is that home? How is it with the children? Are you in a divorce? So it is. It's also here you see kind of very strange mixture in measuring, trying to measure the risk you take with somebody and trying to measure again this promise of a good ID, what I mentioned before. you see this involved more and more in this kind of, what are your, this is the main question, what are your personal targets? Personal. As if there are personal targets in an institution like this. There are no personal targets. You have to teach here. It's not a personal target. It's a target of the institution. It's of education. But you have to reframe it as a personal thing, which is from your own, which you incorporate, in which you are emotionally affected with. And this is the whole new system of neo management. And at the same time, because of this market orientation, you see, I talked already a little bit about this. I mentioned already before the break. Because of this market orientation, you get a kind of panic in schools. Panic in that sense, oh, this school has more students now than we. We have to follow, or we have to be connected with the labor market. But in fact, nobody knows how the labor market will look in 5 years, especially not for creative professions. So, and what do they do then at schools, especially the manage, they implement every 5 years a completely other organization, a curriculum, and other strengths to work in, etc. So this change management, there's no problem with change in an institution, but change becomes the kind of general modus of the system. So this means that you are always have to deal with the paperwork of change when you are in such an institution. And at the end, you're only busy with change management. So this is also the only thing what management understands when you manage yourself. And this is, of course, at the moment, the situation also, that the management always stays in charge. People go, artists go, and especially artistic teachers go and come in. But managers stay in charge because they implement, again, this kind of change management, and they make themselves relevant by this. They stay in charge of this system, and in the center also. They have the fixed jobs. They have the fixed contracts, not the artists. And not the professors even. Even the University of Amsterdam, you have contracts of 2 years. As a professor, full professor, 2 years contract. And again, you have to apply. And again, insecurity. We talked about it yesterday. This gives an enormous insecurity. But again, think about this Marcuse who was standing here and say, give people their freedom. No fixed contracts anymore. You can work here as a freelancer. And you have, as a management, all the tools in your hand to have the total power of an institution. You have back total institutions when you manage them like that. And what we see also at, let's say, at the shop floor or in the classroom, is that, in fact, those schools, the catering regime takes over. And I mean it's literally. It's the catering who is doing the job in a way in all the thing. I mean, not only catering of food, there it starts, of course, but it is also catering of courses. It's catering of the copies. It's catering of the books, where you have to sell it and which tenure contracts you have of the European committee, etc. So everything is catering. What is typical for catering? Catering is delivering quality food, but not the best, of course. But you have to bring it in time and the right proportion. That's the catering philosophy about, because otherwise you get a collapse of your catering company when you do it, not bring it in time. And so what is this catering regime doing? It's more and more you see also courses are catered, programs, modules, as we called it, are catered in school systems more and more. And this is also a way of biopolitics. It's really, really not only buy food, but it's also really whole your life as a student is and definitely as a teacher in such an institution is reorganized in a total way as a catering way. Yeah. Okay. the anecdote of my school was this, and also the analysis of the effect, in a way, of this whole Bologna degree and the effect of also standardization of education at a certain moment. How can you respond? Big question. Okay, now we come much more speculative, etc. So I think what I like, especially, and what I learned from artistic avant-garde is this whole idea of what I call this measure. I mentioned this yesterday already. I said culture is a kind of measure. It gives you habits and values you are connected with, like my 3 cups of coffee every morning. That's a kind of measure. And I think the worth or the value of art is, since modernity, is bringing in this measure, making a shift in it, and trying to make this shift, bringing this shift and shifting the whole system. That's, I think, let's say it in an utopic way or romantic way, the power of art. You can do this as an artist, you can try to do this again and again and again, bring in this kind of this measure. I know it's not good English, but it's also the word itself is a this measure. It does not exist, but it means bringing in the senses also in institutions. So, what can we learn from art? What can we learn from Marcel Duchamp, for example? It's not about playing by the rules like sports. But you are a good sporter when you play the rules and you play by the rules. No, it is playing with the rules, trying to change the rules by the play you play. And I think there we can learn a lot about of attitudes we can bring in back in arts institutions as such. So, putting the rules at stake and putting also school rules at stake. So, trying to bring this measure in this obsession for measurement in the art society. And there are tricks to do this. I start with an old trick which doesn't work anymore. And this was, let's say, until the 80s, you had also big institutions which were very hierarchically organized, sometimes very bureaucratic. For example, public broadcasting systems, amazing machines, very bureaucratic. For every pencil, you have to sign something to get a pencil in this kind of institution. So this was the old institution. But what you had there, because they were so big, you had what I call always the 10%. The 10% who didn't function at all in the system. And 5% of those, oh, so 50% of those, 10% or 5% of this were just drinking at 11 o'clock, even at 9 o'clock. They did nothing in those institutions. But they could, because nobody saw them in this big institution. They were there. And you had the 5% or the 50 of the 10% who did it. They made the creative things. They did what they couldn't not do in those institutions, but they did because nobody saw them in this institution. And they brought I see definitely in broadcasting companies, the public broadcasting company in Belgium, there we had creatives. That was done. So you get high peaks of talent and you had this destructive field under of addicts and people who could do, sometimes also even disabled, who were there but had no place in it, etc. This doesn't work anymore. Why doesn't it work anymore? Because we have neo-management. They find you when you are doing this. So we have to develop other tactics, strategies in this business. And one is a very interesting thing. It is what I call the uses of laziness and abuses maybe also of laziness. When you work in an economy of ideas, nobody can, until now, look in your head if you have a good idea. And nobody can also look how much time you need to have a good idea. You can be busy with developing a good idea for 3 months, or you can have it in 1 second. There you can play with. So on the individual level, at least, you can pretend that you're working on a good idea, but at the same time doing other things. You can make your own time on the individual level. So this is a kind of individual technique to develop and cultivate even. And we are starting with an experiment in a school, don't say it in Antwerp now, with this whole idea of laziness of teachers. For example, I just say, very practical, all the bureaucratic stuff, all the forms you have to fill in individual, mostly at home, at night, when you have no time, and then you have to fill in this kind of things. What we did here, for example, one very trick was, okay, we do it collective. We sit 1 hour together, all, and somebody is very good in it, and he fills it also in for it all. We sit there and we provoke, and it's done. And the rest is our free time. We can be lazy at that moment, but at least then we can do a real job. So it's only a kind of pragmatic way. And still it is pragmatic because you still stay in the system and you still deal with it and you don't block the system. It's not a kind of revolting. It is just dealing with it in a kind of semi-criminal way. Or illegal way. It's in between. It's a gray zone which you can develop. And the other ones is trying to find these places of long-term concentration and focus. And you can find this by, for example, making the work until a minimum. Right? And we see more and more also in the real revolting thing that people say, no, we don't do it anymore. But there's one rule, never say it as an individual. Do it as a collective. And we see it more and more. We are organizing, for example, your university in the Netherlands nowadays, and then it works because the management never fights, and even also the rector never fights against 50 people. Then he feels really pain in the ass, especially when you go to the media, etc. So, but I think it's very important to safeguard those spaces of focus, concentration, your own time also in this space. I mean your own also professional time to do your profession in which you are skilled and what you are worth for and paid for also to do this. I think we need to organize a much more and more collective. So there are two kind of tactics, I would say. One is really staying in the system, but try to, in a semi-illegal way, dealing with it, like those 5% who start drinking, but we do it in another way. Or, so it's dealing with bureaucracy in a very clever way, or it is really revolting and trying to shift time, but then you have to do it in a collective. You have to do it, you need to be with more people. And I have to say, in a way, I'm optimistic because I see more and more, at least also in Belgium, that also the rectors of, you say rector in, also here, yeah, who are voted now are really against this kind of Bologna. What it does, they are not against Bologna, but what it does in school. So you see already a shift again, I think, in how to organize. For example, there's a whole discussion in Belgium now, and it is led by the rectors of the universities about the pressure of publications and this whole competitive thing. So they start at least discussing about it. I don't say that they do already something in the institutions about it, etc. But this is because of collective action and collective, at least writing opinion pieces in newspapers. Okay, I go to the last scheme, last slide. I don't know why I put it here, it's just because I like it anyway. But I try to think through about what this dissensus can mean in teaching in art schools, but also maybe teaching art in primary schools, etc. And I made a very blunt oppositions between how people and even my own children deal with art. I have two boys. One is now 9, and one no is 10, and the other is 13. But even the youngest one, when he was 5, and we went somewhere at the beach, and we saw a public art work, he said, "Oh no, this cannot be art." So you have a kind of relationship of children, but also of more and more of adults who really hate when you say this is art. And you cannot and totally not convince them. And it's very interesting. I see it with my younger son. He's already getting older, and anyway, but he builds really his identity by this kind of what I call segregation. It means that you build up your identity. I'm not like that. It's called negative self-definition. I'm not like that. I like, and he is indicating this really, I hate art. And I like sport. He's a footballer. He likes it. I don't say there is a kind of opposition between sport and art, but this is his way of identifying itself. I think a lot of ways how artists teaches in schools develops this kind of relationship, right? That our students immediately say, young, even when they are 6, 7 years, say, nothing for me, not for me, no, segregation. I'm somebody else, and the question is, how can you, as an teacher in art, go through this and try to change this? But there's also, I think, when you look at populist political parties, it's the same attitude. They say, okay, let it be there, but it's nothing for me. That's segregation. It's not the next step, which we sometimes, in an extreme way, also see. It's really destruction. When you say, we really touch it in its existence, you destroy it. Here's the Rembrandt, which was destroyed. But it's most on the individual level, that people hate so much a kind of cultural production at a certain moment that they destruct it. And I'm very curious, but that was my talk also yesterday, and there's also another book and also another research. I'm very much interested in why people do this, these things, destroying cultural projects in general, etc. We see it also with ISIS now, to say another, where they destroy heritage, etc. Of course, we can say this is a bad thing, and this is a destructive thing, but again, my question is why? And I think one reason is that people cannot make sense of this, but also this cannot make sense, or they are not willing that this makes sense to their own life. So they are searching also to make sense of their own life, and they are searching for signs which identify themselves or give themselves an identity. And when such a thing can be, I don't say this was in this case, but when art can be gives you the feeling that it really violates who you are, you get this kind of violent reaction to culture, response to culture. Okay, how do we try to avoid this in cultural education, arts education? Most of the time we do it or try it. I see it also with my oldest son. Like this, role playing. We put somebody in a beautiful role. For example, my son plays the cello, and that's what he's doing. You are a musician, and you behave then as a musician, and that's your position as a painter here to the painting. So it's kind of role playing. It's putting also socialization, putting somebody in an identity, a fixed identity, a role in a certain way, and you try to make him love his art. But I see it also with my son of 13 years old. In fact, he liked to go to the shallow courses, which is an individual course, but he hates the rehearsals at home. In fact, he hates his whole thing. So he is not comfortable with this kind of role in which he is put. So what can we try to do is to reframe, I think, this kind of role playing to a kind of love game. And when you have a love game, I mean by that that you really try to touch young people, but also art students even, not by putting them in a role, but really try to touch them by the artwork or through artwork itself and what it does and what it says. And for me, it's since avant-garde again, bringing in a kind of dissensus in a structure, something you never seen before and also never recognized before as art, and trying to build a love game. And my favorite picture then is this one. It's really true art and true paint, trying to recontextualize your own context. That's what those young guys, they don't know what they are doing. But anyway, look at their face, how happy they are while they are doing this. But also look at the television in the back, it's still playing. And what they do is very interesting. Of course, they are not doing this consciousness, but what they do is television is for children so dominant in the pictures you get. They say, no, we make our own thing of it. We make another picture of it. I think, I know this is speculative, but for me, this is interesting to think about. How can we get this back in institutions like art schools, or can we get it in primary schools, etc.? How can you cultivate this kind of completely weird anarchy in system and make it this measure? But for me, much more important is how can you make it possible, really literally, through art, redefining your own context? And I think this is also to think about, take with us as teachers in art schools, etc. How can you redefine through your own practice and your own skills the whole institution as an art school around it? And at least I think we have to think about tools which can deliver us this. I stop there. Questions?
Any questions? We have about 10, 15 minutes. 10 minutes, perhaps.
Yeah, hello.
Thank you for this talk. You spoke quite a little, or very little actually, about research in art schools today. Maybe you discussed it yesterday.
No.
But anyway, regarding this topic you called discompetencies, you presented some kind of tactics of resistance, but doesn't research somehow remove this discussion on a more, or could it remove it on a more strategic level? I mean, could not research be a kind of counterforce within arts institutions and institutions of education? What do you think about this kind of option? Do you see it as realistic or what do you think?
Yeah, I see two tendencies about this, especially this research in the arts. And the one is that artists who start this research, etc., try to copy academic research, and they formalize it and really kind of sticked in it, kind of, and then you get back a kind of formalization of research, and it's not very helpful. And the other way around, I see artists, but it has also to do how it is institutionalized and how which place is given to this in institutions to this art, who has at least have at least the play or the place to develop their own methodology and to explore their own methodology. So in fact, their research at the time is also, even making PhDs, is also used to buy time, to be again busy with your own practice, etc. And I have to say, it's often used, this research time, then as an excuse at least to find again those 10% again in your institution. And that means also that you play with the risk that 50% of those 10% doesn't make anything of it, and 5% or 50% of the 10% really works with it. And that's really what I try to do. Yeah, at my new research institute in Antwerp, is trying to make protect this space, define this space where this this can happen. By saying always, also for example, to surgeons, professor surgeons, I mean then, etc., we are doing something else. We are not. That's something else. It's not. It's not sociology. It's not a kind of classical methodology you follow. But it is a kind of, you have to protect it in an institutional way. And what is interesting, the outcome can be, I think, and this only, I'm only talking about my experience, is such a thing like what I said in the second plate, is like those books. It's a very strange, it's not peer-reviewed A1 journal academic stuff what we write in there. It's something in between. It's more essayistic. Sometimes it's a manifesto of an artist. And I think this free place you have to safeguard in a way. And research can be used as a tool, but you have to take it like that then to do this.
It's just a matter of fact that you have been invited here by the research. Bringing those critical views within the frame of research now.
Yeah, thank you very much. did you understood what the remark was? That also I get a space here, in fact, to in a research group. And I see this everywhere. So that research is used, or the project like this are used to buy time again, because nobody knows in the beginning what will be the outcome. And as Kai, you mentioned even that you were the only program in it and that you had to reframe. Was it about this? I don't know. Anyway. Yeah, it was about this. So nobody knows when they bet on it, and that's the interesting space. But I think we have to fight for it again and again and again. It's not the kind of thing we have now. It's not like the old 10% in the old institution. It's, yeah.
More questions? Yes.
So I have a question that concerns this notion of avant-garde. And this idea of how to respond, and through methods of avant-garde. And I was just wondering, like, for example, like, you know, Kurt Schwitters probably is here, and his work is called Merzbau.
How is it called?
Merzbau.
Uh-huh.
And this whole idea of sort of Merz that was, for him, was really like avant-garde and sort of destroying the ideas before that, and then again it turned into a brand.
Mm-hmm.
It eventually turned into a brand, and that is sort of what I would recognize as capitalism's or maybe liberalism's ability to take in something that is against it and then sort of transform
sure.
it into something else.
Sure. Yeah, sure. This can become a commodity. indeed. But I think what is interesting and where you can find the kind of escape route is the essence of the avant-garde, that you can bring it in this measure or something like that, or dissensus also, or the dissensual, as Rancière had called it. It's not about that you bring something new in and then you develop it and you, at a certain moment, make it a market product, if it what happens a lot with this avant-garde art. For me, it's important that you can bring it again and again and again and again. This measure, and this is for me the whole I think so. It is about the space where this can happen and to protect the space or fight for the space again and again. Also, this can be commodified and institutionalized at a certain moment. Sure. And at that moment, you have to be aware and you have to stand ready to do something else and to bring in a kind of new position in it. Yeah, and also maybe when I want to, but I'm now thinking aloud, elaborate this a little bit, it's also try dare to destroy yourself. I mean, dare to destroy your own product at a certain moment also yourself, because this is the hugest problem we see now, for example, in contemporary dance in Belgium, that one choreographer develops one idea for 20 years, builds a huge company around it, and then you are fixed in a complete, and some try and dare also, as one choreographer said, now it's done. And I step out and I go back to the domestic space and the peers to reinvent myself and come with something new. So, but this really, because it has to do with money, it has to do with recognition, and this is sometimes very, you really to deconstruct your own identity almost at a certain moment. Yeah. But for me, that's the avant-garde attitude, and not the, how it becomes commodified afterwards as a brand. Or. But also, it's interesting to play with brands. I think to make the inverse of a brand, it can work. When you
more questions. About when you're talking about this measure and again and this fight for the space where that can happen, how would that resonate with Tommy K. Pava's idea about the third space as a
the market? The third space?
The third space as a hybrid space where sort of also a space of, in a way, not knowing, not yet knowing, where. Mm-hmm. Diversity of voices can be sort of brought together to have a dialogue, and also having to, as you said, dare to destroy yourself in the third space. You also have dare to sort of leave your pre-existing ideas, at least bracket them temporarily, in order to be able to be in a dialogue and see what emerges from that moment.
Yeah. I have only ideas about how you can organize this, and also this relationship by the giving people the possibility to destroy themselves at a certain, I mean destroy, not destroy yourself in a mental, the opposite, instead, giving yourself another role at a certain moment, and giving you also the feeling that you're worthful, even when you don't have a say anymore in an artistic sense or creative sense. This always happens after 10, 15 years with people. And I come with the same answer as yesterday, organize yourself as a circus. So it means trying to develop a kind of cooperative way of working. Not community, not close communities, but it is about like a circus function where family life and economical life and political life and art is in a very heterogeneous way mixed together, and where you can relate on other people's in this kind of system. And then you can you at least have the opportunity when you are working for 10 years, 15 years, as a very creative person, and you are stuck down, you say, okay, I take in this situation, I have my experience, I give it. It's really the family situation again. I can give it to other ones in the company, but I take a step back and I live much more for not the company, but the circus in which you live, etc. And so there are, at least I see, at least experimenting with this kind of exchange. So everything, you never can make it when you work, I'm sure for that, you never can make it when you work as a freelancer. as an individual in this space. You need to work in a completely other way to organize your art in a frame, in a collective way. So dealing with heterogeneity, dealing with the market, dealing with also politics, etc., you only can do this in a good way, I think, by incorporating already economy and politics in your own self-organization and organize it yourself. Yourself, not individually, but as a collective. And then you can make this space, this third space, you said. So it is already redefining the hybridity yourself, or the heterogeneity yourself under your own conditions. And that's why I also really believe in autonomy. But autonomy as a kind of heterogeneous monster. This means that you have autonomy because you can act with a lot of heterogeneous stuff, like economy, money, art, etc. And you try to bring it together in one. Or healthcare, to say something completely different in this space. But this really redefining in your own terms, which can be collective terms, is very important, I think, to have a kind of resistance in this global heterogeneous system. So keeping autonomy is for me, it's also an avant-garde, but also a modern invention, which is very important for every system, universities, law system, political system, and even the market. A market functions only when it functions well, when it functions autonomous.
Combines from his autonomous perspectives all kinds of like networks and materials and people and then how the market kind of likes to appropriate these kind of characters
this artist or this was not an artist, I think, which in the way it is in the picture is completely lost. So I think as an individual trying to do this, or like this actress I thought about with his business card and waiting, they are completely lost because they are not collective. They are not collectively organized and they don't organize themselves collectively. They still think that they can make it as an individual, and that's why they are lost. So I think an answer or response to this is really to think about how can I organize, maybe even as freelancer collectives, I don't know what for, there are several models to think about. I mentioned yesterday also, for example, in London you have Fee22, they are artists on the stock market. So they do it completely different. So there are a lot of ways to try to deal with this, but they all do is work in collectives. And even not, maybe it's collective the wrong word, because it's not that they stick together but it can be even virtual collectives that they share, exchange also information, support each other also. It can be also in a completely virtual way. But this exchange bringing in is very important. Also, I mentioned this also yesterday. This girl in bed is also always in competition, promoting yourself on Facebook, etc. And the question is, how can you get out of this atmosphere of competition? Because only there can exist this kind of third space or common space to develop. But again, it is organizing ourselves and really thinking about ways to organize yourself. It's not a solution, I know. I don't have the golden calf. Sorry?
Like these small pockets of liberty that you organize with your peers.
Yeah, peer-to-peer is a good example to try to... But again, the danger of peer-to-peer is also that you are a very exclusive group which only circles around itself. So I'm for peer-to-peer, but it has to be open peer-to-peer or something like that. I don't, and that's why I stress very much this heterogeneous way of organizing, that you are not only organizing yourself with artists together. It's very important to have an economist in it, or to have a lawyer in it, or to have a surgeon in it. It's and again, I really believe, and maybe I'm too optimistic, that it is possible, because I don't know if I say it today, but I said it definitely yesterday. I'm mixing my lectures, sorry. But did I did not say yesterday? It's an example. We did a summer school. It was called Mobile Autonomy, Exercises in Self-Organization for Artists. That was the summer school. At the end of August, we did it in 2015 in Antwerp. It is also a book. We made a book of it. But the summer school was in an open-air museum, Middelheim. It's in Antwerp. And next to this Middelheim museum, you have a hospital. And we did also in the summer school in the evening about mobile autonomy, lectures. Thomas Hirschhorn was there, etc., etc. Public lectures. And the first evening there was already one surgeon. The last, at the end of the week, there were 10 surgeons in it, sitting there. And indeed, they have the same problems. At least realizing that you have the same, as an artist, the same problems as a surgeon, and a surgeon who's realizing that artists, in fact, are talking very reflexive about autonomy, about their own way of self-organization, and they recognize this is at least the key, I think, to find connections and make a kind of cooperatives with a lot of different professions in which everybody is. So I see definitely ways, at least, to organize, because a lot of people feel the same. We are in the same condition at this moment.
Thank you so much, Pascal, and thank you for the
participation.
Thank you for the questions. If the doctoral students of Tuotikyakuva would remain two more or three more minutes here, we still have a couple of things to talk about before.
Did you go and see an exhibition called Dissensus of Kiasu?
Ah, no.